A Musical Life with composer and P.D.Q. Bach Miss Historian Peter Schickele. Peter Schickele has written over 100 works for a wide variety of orchestral, chamber, and vocal ensembles and genres, as well as scores for film and television. As the world's leading, only authority on P.D.Q. Bach, the oddest of J.S. Bach's 20-odd children, Professor Schickele has, for the past 50 years, unwittingly lampooned classical music culture with his missed discoveries of works for such bizarre instruments as the left-handed sewer flute, the windbreaker, and the bicycle siren. This episode of A Musical Life is brought to you by A Musical Life Mastermind. A Musical Life Mastermind is a place where I teach musicians how to be entrepreneurs, drawing upon my own experiences as a classical pianist, co-founding a tech company, teaching hundreds of online music students, and hosting a podcast with 250,000 downloads so far. Every week, we have live mastermind sessions, which are group video chats where we feature case studies and share ideas to help each other find more students, get more gigs, and explore creative ways to grow a career. If you're looking for a better way to make a living as a musician, I'd like to invite you to join the community at A Musical Life Mastermind. To get started with a free ebook on the number one resource you need to grow your music, visit amusicallifemastermind.com. Once again, that web address is amusicallifemastermind.com. Welcome to A Musical Life. I'm Hugh Sung. Peter Schickele has been one of my musical heroes since childhood, ever since my first general music teacher played one of his P.D.Q. Bach albums in class and had everyone howling with laughter. From his humble beginnings as the only bassoon player in Fargo, North Dakota, to his collaborations with legendary folk singer Joan Baez and score for the seminal sci-fi movie Silent Running, as well as his long-running radio show Schickele Mix on Public Radio International, Peter Schickele is perhaps best known for his comedic persona as P.D.Q. Bach, the 21st of J.S. Bach's 20 children, and the only dead composer who can still take commissions. What a thrill to have Peter and P.D.Q. on my show. To give you a taste of the zany musical madness about to ensue in this interview, let's listen to an excerpt of Menuetto No Sueto from P.D.Q. Bach's string quartet in F major, nicknamed The Moose, catalog number SY2K. Peter, oh my goodness, what an honor and a delight to have you here on the show.
My great pleasure.
Now, I understand that in one of your childhood homes, you had the distinction of being the only bassoonist in Fargo, North Dakota. That in itself, right. That in itself sounds like the basis for a great comedy sketch of some sort. What, what attracted you to the bassoon, and do you blame it for your unique sense of classical music humor?
What happened was that my mother had played clarinet in college, and she still had her old BAME system clarinet around the house. Oh, wow. And I started playing it, And it became obvious that I was getting seriously interested in music. So I was sent to a very fine clarinetist in Fargo, Moorhead.
Wow.
And he listened to me for about a minute and a half and said, "You know, Peter, you've got so many bad habits on the clarinet, another instrument." And he suggested the bassoon.
Oh, no.
And I found out later he had an ulterior motive, because Fargo Moorhead had quite an ambitious community orchestra, but it had no bassoonists.
Uh-huh.
Became Fargo's only bassoon, and I never regretted it, because people always need a bassoon. I got to play in all sorts of things that I never would have gotten to play in if I'd played clarinet, because people are always always looking for bassoonists.
How fascinating. Well, one of the most surprising things that I learned about your early education, in addition to you learning to play the bassoon, is that you were the first and only student in your class to graduate from Swarthmore College with a degree in music. It's actually a college that I happen to have grown up pretty close to. It must have been hard playing all the orchestra instruments all by yourself at the same time. How did that work, being the only music major at the time?
Fortunately, I didn't have to do that, because although Swarthmore had a very minimal music department at that point, a lot of the students were very interested in music. And so it had an orchestra, and also we students put on a weekly chamber music series in one of the small halls there on campus. And so there was an awful lot of music being made, and I wrote a lot of music and heard it played by my fellow students. And I really needed to go to Juilliard after that, but I don't regret Swarthmore. I really enjoyed it.
How lovely. I understand that you studied composition while you were in high school, and then you also received your master's degree from Juilliard in musical composition. Now,
right.
While you were at Juilliard, I understand that you teamed up with conductor George Mester, or was it Jorge, or was it George?
Take your pick.
Okay.
He's Hungarian origin, grew up in Mexico, but he's very American, has lived in this country since high school.
Oh, okay.
And so his friends call him George.
Okay.
Sometimes people call him Jorge. It doesn't matter.
All right. But
yeah, he and I and some other friends put on a humorous concert at Juilliard in 1959, and that turned out to be an annual affair, and turned eventually into the P.D.Q. Bach concert.
Okay. Well, I'm wondering, what gave you the idea of putting together this humorous concert?
Well, I place the blame on Spike Jones, who, mid-40s particularly, and after, had a comedy band. He did mostly takeoffs on the on the popular music of the day, but he did some very famous classical pieces like the Nutcracker Suite and Carmen. And I was a Spike Jones freak when I was 10 years old, and spent a lot of time. Not only did I spend my allowance collecting his records, but my brother and I and our friends used to sit around, particularly in the summer when we had a lot of time, and act the records out for each other. I could still do it syllable by syllable.
Oh, my goodness.
Turned my kids onto it. So, and what happened was that I originally got interested in it for the comedy. I mean, I was always sort of theatrically inclined. And then during my teenage years, I got more and more interested in the music for its own sake.
Fascinating. Wow. Can you describe what was actually played in that first comedic concert at Juilliard?
Yeah, but first I want to tell you who was in my little wannabe Spike Jones band.
Please do.
It was called Jerky Jems and His Bomby Brothers. And it consisted of two clarinets, violin, and tom-tom. That's what we had.
Oh, my.
At Juilliard, it was a chamber orchestra consisting of a few strings and single winds, I think, flute, oboe, clarinet, bassoon, and horn and trumpet. And the music was literally written overnight. I mean, the two nights before the concert, I was up all night writing music and handing it to friends who were copying it. So it was on the rough side. It's probably just as well there isn't a recording of that. But as I say, it did break the ice. And also, George Mester and I were out at Aspen that summer of 1959, studying in Aspen. And we put on a humorous concert there as well. And so both in Aspen and Juilliard, it became an annual affair at the end of the season. And we did that for 6 years before I first did the first public concert in 1965.
Wow. And was that was in the Town Hall in New York City, is that correct?
Right.
And then eventually by 1972, it was moved to Avery Fisher Hall in Lincoln Center. What a big upgrade.
We actually played over the years. We played Carnegie and Avery Fisher, and then back briefly once to Town Hall. We played quite a few halls in New York, and it was an annual affair. I think we went for about 43 years doing it every year.
Oh my goodness!
So it was quite a tradition.
Oh, that's wonderful! Oh my goodness! Well, now I need to add that you happen to be the world's leading, and I might add, only authority on P.D.Q. Bach, the youngest and oddest child of J.S. Bach's prolific brood. I'm wondering if you could tell us the origins of this hilariously misunderstood character.
Well, what happened, as often, I think most humorists, at least in music, I think most humorists did not originally set out to be humorists. They set out to be, you know, Victor Borge studied piano and Anna Russell studied singing. But then they found out that they had this ability to make people laugh. And it sort of grows out of that. And what happened in my case was that my brother and I had a friend in Fargo named Ernie Lloyd, who was a cellist and a horn player, and he was also interested in electronics. He was like to, you know, make his own a radio set and things like that.
Wow.
So we got interested in overdubbing, and I'm talking about 1953, I think this was. So it wasn't as easy as it is now of just push a button. You had to match the impedance of the two tape recorders and everything, which he was into, not me. I wouldn't know the difference, but... anyway, we got together, hooked up two tape recorders, and recorded the first movement of the second Brandenburg Concerto with my brother playing the high parts on the violin and Ernie playing the low string parts on the cello and me playing all the solo wind parts on the bassoon two octaves lower.
Wow.
Which sounded sort of like mud wrestling, but a lot of fun. But let's get together again next week and do something else. Well, we'd been listening to the Bach Coffee Cantata, which is one of his few humorous works. So I showed up with the Sanka cantata.
For folks who don't know, this is the Sanka, the instant coffee brand. Is that right?
Yeah, this is a long time ago. And so we recorded that, and then we decided to make the recording in the form of a radio broadcast.
Oh.
So if we were going to have a radio broadcast, we had to have a composer. And one of the three of us suggested P.D.Q. Bach, P.D.Q. being an expression from the 20s. My mother said she knew it when she was young. And it means P.D.Q. means pretty damn quick. And it was used the way ASAP is used now. You know, get over here, P.D.Q.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that.
Somebody suggested that. None of the three of us remembers which one it was who suggested it. Ernie's mother said it was Ernie, but she wasn't there, so I don't know about that. And but we played the recording to friends. It was not, there was no further idea of having it, you know, out in the world or anything. We just played it to friends. And then 6 years later, without anything having happened in between, we started doing these concerts at Juilliard in Aspen. And so it was very gradual. And when I started doing the yearly concerts, I thought, well, all these pieces must be by the same composer. And that P.D.Q. Bach came back to mind. And so it was that casual and that unplanned.
Just a natural extension of your creativity, it sounds like. Now, right. I want to just delve into a little bit of this. Some of P.D.Q. Bach's best-known works include such classics as, and I'm going to try to read this without laughing out loud, "O Little Town of Hackensack," "A Little Nightmare Music," and the dramatic oratorio "Oedipus Text," featuring the OK Chorale. And I'll have to give my listeners a second to catch the pun on that spelling. I think I'm a big fan of his trance and dental etudes written for the Uber Clavier, which is apparently was a 15-octave keyboard with an upper range that only dogs could hear and a lower range that only whales could make. Are there any other important compositions you think our listeners need to be subjected to for a fuller appreciation of PDQ's contributions to the literature?
Well, that's a hard one because there are over 100 P.D.Q. Bach works out there now. I mean, that's more than Webern wrote. So the ones you mentioned are old favorites. And then there's also an oratorio called The Seasonings, which features some of the favorite instruments. He wrote for unusual instruments, such as the slide whistle and the bicycle and the left-handed sewer flute.
But in vain, for he interrupted her, saying,
"Open sesame seeds and see what you see.
And so it's really hard to name favorite pieces when there's so many out there. You know?
We'll have to let our listeners start to dive in and explore some of this wonderful, wonderful literature. Now, you mentioned a couple of the interesting instruments. You're, in addition to being a composer and a Miss historian, let's talk a little bit more about some of these rather ingenious musical inventions, such as, I believe, the dill piccolo for playing sour notes, the the trombone, which is a cross between a trombone and a bassoon, having all the disadvantages of both instruments, and I think my favorite, the pastaphone, an uncooked tube of manicotti pasta, which is played like a horn. Which recordings can you recommend that feature the sounds of some of these unique instruments?
The second recording of P.D.Q. Bach on Vanguard, there are a lot of recordings, and they're all still available. Half of them on Vanguard and half of them on Telarc. And the second Vanguard recording features the Seasonings, but it also features the Pervertimento, which features the bicycle, bagpipes, and balloons. And that's certainly one of them. Playing a solo on the siren on the bicycle is very impressive and hard to do, actually. It's one of the harder P.D.Q. Bach instruments to play.
Thank you.
But you mentioned several of the instruments there, and another one I've been using in my recent concerts is the proctophone.
Oh, I think
the less said about that instrument, the better. And it consists of a trombone mute with a mouthpiece in it. And then out of the other end of the mute is coming a surgical glove.
Oh, no.
When you play the notes on the instrument, the surgical glove inflates and provides a visual interest.
Oh, my goodness. I'm having flashbacks for my childhood in general music class. And I believe my teacher at the time played one of your records. And, you know, we thought we were learning about Bach and Beethoven and Mozart. Right. And suddenly we hear this recording and the class, we were just young kids, but we were howling. We had never heard anything so funny. I'm wondering, you really seem to have touched a nerve with your unique sense of humor in terms of poking fun at something that really, in and of itself, you had mentioned J.S. Bach's own real-life humorous work, the Coffee Cantata, but really most of classical music is awfully serious. What is it, do you think, about your humor that works so well inside such a staid form like classical music?
Well, in the first place, what you say is true. I mean, Bach music was very serious, and as a matter of fact, the Coffee Cantata, if you don't know German, there's nothing funny about it. The only humor is in the words about a man trying to get his daughter to pay attention to him and not to stop drinking coffee. I mean, that's it's a real laugh riot. But I think that you're right that the habits of classical music tend to be stuffy, and it's too bad because most classical musicians are not stuffy themselves. But the protocol of classical music sort of comes from the late 19th century when people used to really, you know, dress up in black tie and tails to go to concerts and stuff. But as I say, it's not only classical music. Spike Jones, he did takeoffs on popular songs of the day. So and there was just as much humor there. Mm. I think it's just a field that's sort of waiting to be done. And what's interesting is that there are never that many musical humorists around. It's actually fairly hard to do in the sense of doing it regularly and doing it often and doing it a lot. You know, usually you have Spike Jonze and Victor Borge and Anna Russell, a few people around, but not a lot. And I was lucky, I think, to have started this in the 60s because that was the heyday of the long playing record. And the long playing record made it possible for record companies to record the complete Haydn symphonies and the complete Mozart string quartets and the complete this and that. And people were suffering from what a friend of mine called Baroque backlash in some cases. And, so it was a particularly good time to start doing that.
Mm. Now, all fun and jokes aside, you are also a serious and prolific composer with over 100 works for orchestra, choral groups, chamber music, vocal works, and you also write for movies and television spanning a wide range of genres, not just classical music, but also writing for folk artists like Joan Baez. For folks who would want to get a better sense of your quote-unquote serious compositional style, what works would you recommend that they start listening to?
I have a website which is linked to a catalog of my works. So the catalog tells which works are recorded. Now, some of them have gone out of print, but mostly they're still available. There's one work for horn and orchestra called Pentangle, which is one of my favorites. It's basically a horn concerto, but it was written for a wild guy who said, I don't want just a regular horn concerto. I want something a little off the wall. And so he, in one movement in the scherzo, he does magic tricks while he plays. I mean, he has trouble playing the note on the horn, and then he pulls a scarf out of the horn and then pulls a rabbit out. And then in the last movement, it's a quasi folk song. The text is from these probably 17th century, and I wrote the melody, but he sings the song in between playing the horn. That's certainly one of my favorite works, and that last I heard was still in print.
Well, that's wonderful. That's as I mentioned, you were the composer for some film scores as well, including the seminal sci-fi classic Silent Running. Can you tell us a little bit about your work in film as well?
Well, I was busy scraping paint off my wall in a house that I'd bought in Brooklyn, and the phone rang, and it was Hollywood calling. It was really a sort of a cliched situation. The director, Douglas Trumbull, was calling, and the thing I liked about this was that I was already quite well known for P.D.Q. Bach, but he was calling me not because of P.D.Q. Bach. He'd never heard of P.D.Q. Bach. He was calling me because of the work I'd done for Joan Baez.
Ah.
And he had the good sense to know that when you hear something and it says arranged by Peter Schickele, that the arranger has something to do with the sound of the music. So he liked that, and I ended up writing the music for Silent Running. And I wrote a couple of songs that Joan Baez sang on the soundtrack. I love writing for movies, but I haven't done much of it because the trouble with movies is they always want you to start tomorrow.
They don't give you much time.
Yeah, they get the rest of the movie done and they say, now let's get the music. Mm-hmm. And I did in the old days so much concertizing that I couldn't commit myself to 6 weeks out in Hollywood, you know?
Oh my.
And so I did 4 feature films, and I did various shorter films. One of my most fun one was that I did the music for a film version of Where the Wild Things Are, the Maurice Sendak book. And I could do that because it was only 8 minutes long. And so even with my concertizing schedule, I could do that. But unfortunately, there's just not time for everything.
Can you tell us how you came to collaborate with Joan Baez, the legendary folk singer?
That's because we were both on Vanguard Records, and I did a Christmas album for Joan. Somebody had the idea of doing an album in which the carols were arranged with the flavor of the period that they came from.
Oh.
In other words, Renaissance carols would be for Renaissance instruments, recorder and viols and organ and 18th century instruments that Haydn and Mozart used, and 19th century carols like O Holy Night were for harp and strings. And that album turned out very nicely. Actually, I'm telling this backwards. It was the other way around. First, Vanguard got interested in doing P.D.Q. Bach. because we had some tapes from Aspen and Juilliard from the times we'd done P.D.Q. Bach out there. So we had some tapes to play to people, and a guy who became my manager got Vanguard interested. And then because of the nature of that, of doing of sort of working in a different style, when they started thinking about this Christmas album, I occurred to them because of writing in these different styles. So that's how, you know.
So it was really your creativity in kind of mimicking multiple styles that actually got the attention of folks who were looking precisely for that, not necessarily for the humor.
Yeah, exactly. And Joan Baez turned into three albums. I did another album of modern folk songs, Dylan and the Beatles and various tunes. And then I did an album called Baptism, which was a very strongly anti-war album that she did, in which she sang and read poems. And I wrote music. Some of them turned into songs, and some of them was background music. And then the two songs for Silent Running, I had a very productive and very pleasurable time working with Joan Baez. We got along very well.
It's amazing how one thing leads to another. It's amazing when we look back on certain events in our lives. As Steve Jobs once put it, you start to see the connections. You see the strings that attach one seemingly random thing to another. And it's amazing to see how your work in some comedy music leads to some folk music, leads to film music. Some really remarkable connections there.
Right. And particularly when you're a freelancer, as I have been all my life, you really notice those connections.
Mm. Now, you're currently collaborating with pianist Jeffrey Beagle to write a piano concerto for him. How is that coming along?
Well, as I mentioned, the P.D.Q. Bach is the only dead composer who can still be commissioned. And he has commissioned the discovery of a P.D.Q. Bach piano concerto for him to play. And this is a new thing for me. I'm really having fun because I don't have to keep this thing easy enough for me to play. Very good pianist, much better than I. And I'm working on that right now, and it's a major work. It'll be probably a 20-minute concerto. I don't know what to say about it, except that it's turning out to be typical P.D.Q. Bach.
I guess there are some nice surprises that you don't want to reveal too soon. We want to share the laughs for when Jeffrey does. I can't wait to see Jeffrey do something funny on stage.
Yeah, right. Well, he'll do a few things, I assume. And also, there's P.D.Q. Bach not only did things that people find funny, but he also was, as somebody said recently, a visionary composer. In that his music often breaks into things that sound like jazz or folk rock or tangos or all sorts of stuff. So I've already, in the piano concerto, there are already some licks that sound like they're right out of jazz.
Oh, that's really cool. And this is a perfect segue to my next question. Now, it's interesting. Because for over 15 years, you were actually the host of a radio show called Schickele Mix, where you explored amazing connections across a wide range of musical genres, just similar to what you're describing, the way that your persona, P.D.Q. Bach, writes and yet is, weaves in all their styles into the music. Can you share some examples of the really interesting topics you covered with your show and some of the most maybe interesting musical connections you shared with your listeners?
Well, I loved doing that show. It was, I did it. I worked on it here at home in New York City, but I went out to St. Paul, Minnesota to record it, partly because my producer lived out there and had worked at the public radio out there. And then also they have a wonderful record library out there, all sorts of great stuff. And the people who work in the station are hanging out in the record library. So, for instance, I would go in there and say, I'm working on a show about bagpipes. If anybody's got anything interesting, let me know. And within an hour, one of the guys showed up with a record that had Send in the Clowns played on the bagpipe.
Oh, my goodness.
To what was going to turn up from that library.
For tidbit time today, I've got an old recording fragment that might be called a singer's worst nightmare. This serious rendition of an aria from La Bohème has been circulating underground for years. Several people have played it to me, and none of them knows who it is. Though I know nothing of the provenance of this gem, I'm convinced that it was not done for comedic purposes, because I can't imagine any real singer doing what you are about to hear to his voice. This must be from the 1920s, anyway. We're talking basement fidelity here, but be patient. A vocal train wreck of mythic proportions. This can happen, you know, even to decent singers. I've heard a more recent example that took place on a broadcast from a major American opera house. It has to do with going for it, I think. Like it's no accident that Babe Ruth, the king of home runs, was also the king of strikeouts. Maybe what I love best of all about this tape is that the guy goes right on as if nothing has happened.
So I would actually record the program out there. And as you say, I would often look for interesting and unusual similarities. This came originally from me, from copying music, when I was a young composer and could not afford a copyist yet and had to copy out my own solo parts. I would put a record player on. This is the days of the LP record. So, you know, you put a bunch of records on and they'd automatically switch. It's copying, listening to music while you copy is not the best way to copy. It does lead to a few mistakes. But copying is so boring that you often have to do something. So, but what happened was that I would, since I have very eclectic tastes in music, I would put records on the changer in which, you know, maybe one would be a Mozart string quartet and the next one would be a medieval mass and the next one would be Jerry Mulligan jazz recording. And I started noticing similarities between these very different kinds of music. And that was really the genesis of the program. It took decades before I had the opportunity to do the program. But it finally, in the 80s, I decided that I was ready for a little break from P.D.Q. Bach. I'd been touring up to 60 concerts a year.
Oh, my.
And I just felt I wasn't tired of it, but I wanted a little break. So I, being a practical man, I waited till my youngest kid was out of college and stopped touring, which is how I made most of my living. And started doing this radio program. And, well, let's see. I remember the very first program that I talked about the surprise of jumping up an octave. There's a Mozart aria that goes, da, 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 dee, da, dee, da, something like that. When you skip up an octave like that, it's a big enough interval so that the effort required produces a real surprise. And I put together these suites for these programs, consisting of three or four or five examples of what I was talking about. And I would not identify the pieces before the suite. That was one of the important things. So that you wouldn't have preconceived notions. I did identify them afterwards. I certainly would want to know what they are, but not beforehand. I did about, I think 170 programs.
Wow.
Then we ran out of money, and so I couldn't do any more. And unfortunately, I really missed doing that show. Mm. But it was certainly one of the things I most enjoyed doing.
I mean, it sounds like that kind of a program is just the most creative way to get people interested in more esoteric musical theory subjects, understanding the composition and structure of music that bridges all genres, no matter what kind of music you're listening to or playing.
Yeah, I never have thrown a record away in my life. I've lost some, but I've never thrown them away. And so I used to show up at the radio station there with a couple with some very wild, off the beaten path records, and so you heard a lot of music that you might not have heard otherwise, or you certainly wouldn't have heard otherwise. Anyway, life changes, and that had its time, and that time passed.
Now, getting back to your compositional side, I was reading that in one of your interviews, you made an interesting observation. You stated that you felt like contemporary classical music, for want of a better term, had gotten too far away from folk music. I'm wondering if you could explain what you meant by that.
My own taste in music is such that I like sort of a grounding in key and rhythm. The kind of contemporary music that grew out of Schoenberg's explorations, where you consciously seek to avoid a beat, a sense of beat, and avoid a sense of key, is not my favorite kind of music. I like all kinds of music, including some atonal music. It's not that I don't like any of it, but it's not. I tend to like a grounding in folk music in the broadest sense of that term. I don't mean that it should sound like Burl Ives or something, but that, for instance, when I set vocal music, I love to have several verses to the same music, the way folk music usually does.
I see.
Where you have a bunch of verses to the same music. Now, and that's one of the reasons that I rarely set contemporary poetry. I like a lot of contemporary poetry, and my wife is a contemporary poet, but with free verse, you can't do that. You can't set several verses to the same music. And I guess I always hesitate in talking about this because I don't like to sound too old-fashioned, because that's not helpful and it's not true. I don't old-fashioned composers, I don't necessarily like them better than far-out composers. But I do like some sort of groundwork there.
And it's interesting because it seems like we're having a renaissance with a lot of the younger composers this generation that are returning to a much more tonal grounding, if you will, music that carries a tune, music that just much more appealing to folks who are not familiar with classical music, who might have been scared away before, but hear these new compositions. It's suddenly something that they can fall in love with and not be frightened off by.
Yeah, I love it because when I was growing up, there was a lot of animosity between the various camps of contemporary music, you know, and a lot of people regarded tonal music as too old-fashioned and they weren't interested in it at all. But what you say is true is that the contemporary composers have gotten interested in some of those things in all sorts of different ways. It's not just that everybody's going back to writing songs that could have been written 50 years ago, but it's that the tonality and the beat and the rhythm have been used in all sorts of different ways. And it's often true that people get this idea that the contemporary music has a way of development that is a straight line. But what often happens is what shakes things loose comes out of left field. And in the case of classical music, the biggest example of that was minimalism.
Yes.
Which this music that a lot of people couldn't stand for another reason, but it brought key back and it brought beat back and it And in the end, it ended up bringing melody back. And the very first examples of minimalism were, some of them, rather austere. But it ended up really sort of breaking things loose.
Mm. And attracting brand new audiences, I would say, to classical music in general. Something that they could understand and yet, you know, develop a more sophisticated taste as they grew and as they were exposed to more and more of that.
I was a friend of Philip Glass's at Juilliard, in Juilliard days, and he told me years later, he said that he'd worked hard to get his records out of the classical department and get them put into the pop area, because it was young people who liked his music. It was the old classical people didn't necessarily like it. And when I went to visit my daughter at Carleton when she was going there, I walked down the hall and every other door they were playing Phil Glass's music.
How about that?
And so he actually made a point of getting his music out of the classical music bins.
Mm. You know, in many ways, you've been a trailblazer for a truly entrepreneurial approach to a musical career. Just the fact that you've really focused yourself as a freelancer rather than, say, pluck yourself into a conservatory teaching position or a resident composer someplace. You've really created your own career, your own way, and broke boxes and made fascinating bridges where none existed before. I'm wondering, what advice do you have for musicians looking for ways similar to what you did to create out-of-the-box careers and opportunities?
Well, my basic advice for composers is always hear what you write. Write for things that you know people who will play it. So that you can really hear it, because there's nothing like hearing it. But in terms of making a life, that's not so easy. At the beginning, I thought I was going to be a teacher, because that's the way most composers make a living. And I assumed that I was going to go on to get a PhD and teach somewhere. And P.D.Q. Bach changed that. I ended up being able to make a living from P.D.Q. Bach. And I've preferred that. I like teaching, but I get restless after a while with teaching. I want to spend more time writing music. And I know a lot of composers who feel the same way, who nevertheless have to teach. But yeah. It just worked out that P.D.Q. Bach made that unnecessary for me.
Mm. So in addition to Jeffrey Beagle's Piano Concerto, are there any other projects or any other plans that you're working through currently? Any other things that you'd like to share with our listeners?
Well, yeah, I have a couple of commissions usually on the fire, and in this case, I'll be working on the piano concerto certainly up until the summer, and but I already have a commission for an a cappella choral work that will be a Peter Schickele piece. I don't like to talk about myself in the third person, but in my case, and there are a couple of other pieces that I may be writing that I'm talking with about commissions too. So I've been fortunate in having commissions both for Peter Schickele and P.D.Q. Bach.
Wonderful. Oh, before I close our interview, I want to pass along some warm regards from a member of the Lark String Quartet. Her name is Jennifer Orchard. She's right now currently with the Pittsburgh Symphony Orchestra. And we've been chatting online, and she just wanted to express how awesome you all are. And she just warmly remembers the interactions that she had with you. And I believe you wrote your second string quartet for the Lark Quartet. Is that correct?
Yes, I did. I loved working with the Lark Quartet. They were wonderful.
Oh, wonderful. Well, she sends you her very warmest regards.
Well, if you talk to her again, please send them back. And I think she's married and a mother now. And but I haven't seen her for many years.
I'm sure she'd be thrilled to hear from you. In fact, after we finish the interview, I'm going to go ahead and share her contact information with you.
Great.
Peter, thank you so much. I don't even know. Maybe I should be addressing you, Peter, PDQ, both of you. Thank you so thank you so much for just a delightful time getting to know you. You've been a childhood hero of mine all my life, and it's such a thrill to be talking to you directly like this. I never would have dreamed that the great PDQ Bach and the great Peter Schickele would be a guest of my own show. Thank you so much.
Well, it's been my great pleasure, and I've enjoyed doing it.
I hope perhaps to have you back on the show when you have some new and exciting things to share.
Thank you, Hugh. It was a pleasure.
You too. Take care.
For links to Peter Schickele's website and music featured in this episode, visit the show notes at amusicallife.com. While you're there, be sure to check out a hilarious video of Peter performing P.D.Q. Bach's concert shtick for two violins and orchestra with Itzhak Perlman and John Williams conducting the Boston Pops Orchestra. As I mentioned at the beginning of this episode, we just crossed over 250,000 downloads of this podcast in only 7 months' time. If you enjoy this show, I hope you'll help me cross the next 250,000 by going to amusicallife.com/review and posting a quick review in iTunes. And for those of you who have already posted reviews, thank you so very, very much. We've got some amazing guests lined up for future episodes, and I can't wait to share their stories with you. Thank you for telling your friends about this show and for all your support. Until next time, I'm Hugh Sung, and I wish you a musical life.